We're going to look at solving equations with radicals when there's more than one square root. So just to review what we did when we had a square root in the equation, we would isolate the square root first, always. Then we square both sides of the equation. And when you have that square root isolated from the first step, squaring it will eliminate the square root. The other side of the equation also needs to be squared. You're going to solve the new equation that you get from that. It'll either be a linear equation or a quadratic equation. And whatever solutions you get from the new equations, you have to check those. Check them in the original equation to make sure that they work. And that's because of the squaring property. Whenever you square both sides of an equation, you potentially pick up new solutions. It's interesting to look at if you were looking at other types of radicals, like cube roots, or fourth roots, or fifth roots, when you take the third power of both sides to eliminate a cube root, or the fourth power of both sides to eliminate the fourth root, how that squaring property would apply to cubing both sides, or fourth power of both sides, especially in terms of whether or not you pick up extra solutions, and when you have to check your answers. I'll give you a hint, it has to do with odd or even. All right, here's an example. Two square roots. Now, when there's two square roots only and no other terms outside of those square roots, you know, there's no plus or minus any other numbers here, then this is not so bad. We've got the square roots isolated right now, right? Since there's only two of them and nothing else, we just put one on either side of the equation. And now when we square both sides, the square will eliminate the square root on the left. And so you're just left with whatever expression was under the radical. In this case, we get a 5x minus 1 for the left side. And on the right side, same thing, square eliminates the square root. So we're just left with the x plus 7 from the inside. And this is a nice linear equation that we get. There's no x squared, so it's just x. So we'll combine our x's on the left side of the equation, whichever side you like, but let's go with the left here. So that gives us 4x minus 1 on the left, 0 plus 7 on the right. Combine our constants, and we get 4x equals 8, and of course dividing by 4, got ahead of myself there, we get x equal 2. Remember the last step, always check the answer. If I plug x equal 2 into the original equation, before I squared both sides, there were two places that I had an x, and I'm going to put a 2 in for both of those. And we can see in this case, we have 10 minus 1 is 9, square root of 9 on the left. 2 plus 7 is also 9. Those definitely look like they're going to be equal. So 2 works. X equal 2 is a solution of the original equation. If you prefer the solution set notation with these set brackets. All right, now we're going to look at a harder example. It's going to have two square roots also, but it's going to have another term in there. And because this one involves a awful lot of steps, I actually worked it all out ahead of time. I'm just going to walk us through these. You cannot isolate both of these radicals. You can put one on either side of the equation, which is what we're going to do. But this plus 1 over here, it cannot be combined with the radical. You can't get rid of it. I could subtract 1 and have a minus 1 on the other side. That would work just as well as leaving it on this side. So you're stuck with the extra term here, we can't get rid of it. Be careful. Here's another warning for you. Probably gave you this warning before in the first video. You cannot just square all the terms. It'd be great if you could. It's a really common mistake to try to square each term separately. That would eliminate these radicals and make it nice and easy to solve, but it's absolutely incorrect to do this. You cannot square the two terms separately on the right side. To do it properly, you have to square both sides of the equation. Right? The whole left side, that one was fine, and the whole right side needs to be squared. And that will not be the same as this. Remember, you cannot distribute an exponent when you have a plus or a minus inside the parentheses. Okay? So you will not get this result. You have to do it the long way. You have two separate terms inside the parentheses here. So squaring it means multiplying that whole thing by itself. And because of the two separate terms, you have to distribute. And when you FOIL that out, when you look at the distribution of all the factors here, the first term times the first term is going to give us root x plus 3 times root x plus 3, or root x plus 3 squared. The inner and the outer products, look at the inner product here, 1 times root x plus 3, and the outer product is another 1 times root x plus 3. So there's two of those when you add them up, and 1 times 1. So here is what we get when we square the right side of the equation. The first term here, the radical disappears, the square cancels the square root, but we're going to be stuck with one here in the middle. So did that help us? Yeah, it did. The radical on the left is gone, and while we did eliminate the radical on the x plus 3 from the initial one, we picked up a new one in the middle. But still, if you look at the entire equation here, despite how complicated this has looked, there's only one radical in this new equation. We started with two, now we only have one. So now if you look at this as an equation with just one radical, one square root, we know our steps, our procedure is going to be to isolate this square root. So let me first do that just by combining the 1 and the 3. That gives us x plus 4. And I'm now going to subtract x from both sides and subtract 4 from both sides so that I get the radical here. I still have the 2 there, but 2 root x plus 3 equals x plus 3. Now, I know we said we have to isolate the radical. That would really involve dividing by 2 on both sides to get rid of this 2. However, it turns out it's not completely necessary to have these coefficients removed. It is possible we could modify that rule to say isolate the radical except for possible coefficients. We definitely want to move these terms to the other side so that we don't have the problem like we did above when we had to FOIL that whole thing out. But if it's just a number times the radical, when you square that, you do not have to FOIL. So here's what we get when we square both sides of that equation. The x plus 3 on the left, and I'm leaving the 2 in front of the radical there. We remember we have a property of exponents that says if it's multiplication, then you can apply that exponent to each factor. So I'm looking at this as two factors, 2 times root x plus 3, the 2 and the square root. And so I can apply that square root separately to each of those. And I can only do that because it's multiplication. So that 2 squared becomes 4. The square root of x plus 3, I square that, I get rid of the square root, and so I'm just left with the x plus 3 from the inside. And of course, the right side over here, there was no radical, I just have to square x plus 3, which means multiply it by itself. And of course, we get x squared plus 6x plus 9. So after two times that we squared both sides of the equation, we had to do it twice to get rid of the radicals. Now we have an equation with no square roots. This is going to be a quadratic equation because of the x squared. So our techniques for solving quadratic equations are to put everything on one side of the equation. So distribute that 4 first, get 4x plus 12, subtract the 4x and the 12 to move them to the left side. That gives us the 0 we want here. That way, if we can factor this, we've got the 0 that we need, or if we wanted to use the quadratic formula, This one factors nicely. I'm going to let you double check the factoring on this. The zero product rule, very important that we have the zero there. So set each factor equal to zero, and that gives you two potential solutions. Notice I said potential solutions. We have to check these to make sure that they work. Negative 3 and 1. Remember to check them in the original equation. Here was the original equation. So I have to plug in, when I'm checking negative 3, I have to plug that negative 3 in for both of these x's in the equation. You can see it done there. It's easy to see that the left side becomes 1, and the right side also becomes 1. So x equals 3, negative 3 makes a true equation. So we have a solution. Check x equals 1, same thing, plug it in for both of the x's. And it's not difficult to see that x equals 1 also gives you a true equation. So 1 and negative 3 are both solutions. And again, you have your two alternative methods for stating your solution sets here. And that wraps it up. This was definitely a difficult example, this one that we just ended with. Typically, you won't see very many of those. If you see one at all, it would be probably one of the last problems that you would see in the homework.